Samanta chakkavalesu atra gacchantu devata. Saddhammang munirajasa sunantu saggamokkhadam. Dhamma savanakalo ayang badanta. Dhammang savanakalo ayang badanta. Dhamma savanakalo ayang badanta. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato samma sambuddhassa.
Yeah, so we have the real, the core, the Dhamma core, the real the real deal here, to be coming here with your down jackets and hats and that's good, Canadian Dhamma. Good. Well, so how's everybody doing? Good. Well, so what today? Today we'll talk about the origination of liberation. So I thought, I was trying to find a kind of a title for it with dependent origination in it, paticca samuppada. And so I haven't really talked much about dependent origination. And just so you know, this is how this is very close to what the Buddha taught about karma, his how there is this chain of causality that basically constitutes our experience of reality, and this whole chain is basically how we behave. So it's really interesting. A lot of people that are into deep psychology are really into that aspect of the path, because it's, well, it really is, like my teacher would say, like the backbone of the Buddha's teaching. And it is really important to understand, because it's everywhere in the teaching. This discourse is particular because dependent origination, paticca samuppada, how things are coming all from a cause. There's nothing that's left to, you know, we don't know what's going on. And the Buddha makes it clear in this chain. We there is the chain of dependent origination where we will see, I'm sure you've heard it before, but how the wheel of samsara turns. And this is, I thought this might be an opportune time to kind of loop back into last year at this very moment in time, where, I don't know, I gave a kind of talk about that last year, and there was fog coming out of my mouth also. So it's about that time of the season, the same thing. And so I touched a little bit in that talk about that, but this is really the sutta where we find there is dependent origination, which is really how samsara works, the wheel of samsara. But the Buddha's teaching also is about how to come off that wheel, to break that cycle, and to release the mind, basically. So, of birth and death and the wondering, constant wondering. You're probably slightly familiar with the notion of samsara in Buddhism, and that basically, because this is quite fundamental to the teaching, the Buddha, when he recollected his past lives before awakening, and the past lives and the how other beings also take on a destination because of their mental states. So basically the way that your mind is at the time of death is, or whatever all constituents that you've either cultivated or developed, whether it's wholesome, whether it's unwholesome, this is basically that volitional force that it's like an inertia that is going to bring you in that direction. So and so basically in Buddhism there is this notion that this is not our first lives. This is, we've been doing this for a long time, whether it's a human form or, you know, higher realms or the lower realms. We've all gone to these states. And now I'm saying that as an information, but not as like you should believe everything that I'm saying without our questioning it. It's really, you know, there's no need to kind of just for anybody to just really accept that out of just sheer faith, but there is a way that you can actually see these things for yourself and with mental development. So there is the outside of that, there is the wheel of the Dhamma, which moves away from the wheel of samsara, which is kind of this thing keeping us in, you know, like I was saying last time, Mara, like the CEO of samsara, he really likes us to stay in here. So he's trying a lot of things, and the Buddha awoke to the truth of Mara's illusion, basically, and started teaching that path of how to break through that cycle. And so there is two folds to this discourse on dependent origination, and you'll see it's not only just the classic way that he explains it, but it's also, he adds his path on top of that. So it's really interesting to see. So and this discourse is called Causes for Liberation. And you know, of course, if it's your first time here, the way that I teach is always reading. I read a discourse from the Buddha, because I think that's quite important for us. I don't think I want to go into great detail, but one of the things that made me really understand how profound this teaching was to actually know what the Buddha said. And I think sometimes we can give, you know, and a lot of traditions are like that, you know, you don't read something while you give a talk. It's really strict kind of thing. You shouldn't read or something. And I could do that, but sometimes talks like that, they can lean towards some things and some other things, and in the end we tend to lose the essence sometimes of what the real core of the Buddha's teaching is. And to be honest with you, I've never encountered one person that was better than the Buddha to teach, so so also that's a security for you. So even whatever I'm saying, you can know that there's some kind of, you know, that you're actually connected to the real teacher in the end. So this is called the Upanisa Sutta, and this is a quite famous discourse, by the way, quite well known. Bhikkhu Bodhi has a very famous translation of this, was one of his first books. Yes. This is in the collected discourses, the Samyutta Nikaya. This is number 2, and that's the book of causality. Causality. Mm-hmm. Which is Nidana. It would be called origination, I guess. Mm-hmm. I call it causality. Oh, good. Good. This is coming soon.
Yes, but I'm actually going to start with book 5.
Mm. Good idea. Very good. Yes, because it's going to give you all the material right away, and then, because you know the one on dependent origination, the causality, number 2, the book number 2 is, and the 6 senses, it's good to have, you know, the whole mental development sequence and information to read before you, because this is exactly the sutta, and there's not really another, there are some similarities with others, but this is a very unique, I guess, teaching. That so this is at Savatthi, and the Buddha says, I say that it is by knowing and seeing, monks, that there comes to be the stilling of distractions, not by not knowing and not seeing. Knowing and seeing what? These are shapes manifesting, and these are shapes passing away. These are felt experiences, these are experiences manifesting, and these are experiences passing away. So here he goes through the 5 fabrics of self, what we call ourself, in relation to impermanence, and we've seen this in the previous talk also. And that's often what he says, for one who sees, not for one who doesn't see. And seeing what? Is that all these things are impermanent. These are concepts, these are concepts manifesting, these are concepts passing away. These are mental activities, these are mental activities manifesting, and these are mental activities passing away. This is consciousness manifesting, this is consciousness passing away. Knowing and seeing in this way, monks, there is the stilling of distractions. Now here, of course, the Buddha's teaching on impermanence in regards to these 5 aspects of what we call me is very at the very core of his teaching, is very important. And it's good for us to understand that in the end, when we perfect the skill of letting go always of hindrances, of unwholesome states, attachments, and preferences, judgments, opinions, name it. What is there to hold on to after? And so when there's nothing to hold, well then you see how everything is just passing by. So there is really just this constant letting go. So it's the result and also the practice of letting go. So this is not just this is very profound. And you know, I spend hours, translating talks or reading these talks, and every time I have to stop. And I just to process that information. And not like, it's not something you can really think about, but it's just that impression on your mind that it makes, that is just very profound. Because when you understand that, you understand letting go, really. And this is the basis for his whole chain that he's going to explain. But monks, I say, in this stillness, this very knowledge of stilling comes from a cause. It is not independent. So this just doesn't happen just like that. It happens for a reason. And here I translate, this is asavakaya. So this is what Bhikkhu Bodhi would call the destruction of the taints. Just so you know, I call it distilling of distractions, or distilling, well, just stilling the mind, really. And yes, this is a... bald eagles. They've been gone for a little bit. Oh no. Good. I haven't heard them. So what is the cause for the knowledge of the stilling? Release should be answered. And so now we have to understand we're really starting from like the really end goal, right? So just bear that in mind, that you know, this, when there's no more of the five hindrances, like the Buddha says, they've been cut off at the root, made like a palm stump, they're no longer able to arise again, like selfishness, like, you know, like strong greed or anger, or you know, all these things, simply they've been eradicated. They cannot arise any longer. So the purity of the mind is just unshakable. And that's that very stilling that he's talking about. And so he says this is based on vimutti. Vimutti is that liberation, that release. But this release comes from a cause. It is not independent. What is the cause for release? Letting go should be answered. Six, viraga. Yes, so this is the same when I was explaining viraga last time. So this is viraga, and I called it letting go right now, but it's actually just calming down and relinquishing all of that. Like, it's that aspect of really... letting go, but to a higher degree, not just letting go once. It's like this complete kind of letting go. But this letting go comes from a cause. It is not independent. What is the cause for letting go? Disengagement should be answered. And I think this is Nibbida. Because the one that comes before this is discernment. So when we start to understand and see things the way that they truly are, there is this thing that arises, which is that disengagement. There is this, we understand the nature of being constantly engaged in the senses, for example, which is very, very heavy and distracting. And then, but once we, this is very closely connected to the four understandings of the Aryas, of the awakened ones. So basically understanding these four noble truths, and Nibbida would be basically kind of what comes after. It's just that it's really close to letting go, but disengaging in through discernment, wisdom, basically. It's not just disengaging, because sometimes I use that in the first jhana, for example. This is not the same. This is a bit further. You know, this is when the Four Noble Truths are really kind of, they're doing that action of like being like a Teflon. like nothing is sticking anymore. It's like, okay, just like this embodied disengagement. Through discernment. What is the cause of disengagement? Discernment should be said. And this is discernment is a really short word that I put there, but this is yathabhutang jnanadasanam. So it's seeing and understanding things as they are, as they truly are. So this is also called the knowledge and vision of things the way they are, or something like that. But I thought, you know, discernment is a pretty, you know, one word kind of description that can pinpoint that kind of concept. Of course, you can do a lot of things with words, but and that means especially knowing and seeing what as it is, especially mental states, especially the nature of mental states and the nature of greed, hate, and delusion, and the nature of non-greed, non-hate, and non-delusion, and practicing to abandon the first one and to cultivate the second one. But this discernment is not independent. What is the cause of discernment? Mental collectedness should be answered. So this is samadhi. And now we're really starting to see, what is this meditation? What's the purpose of meditation? Well, actually, the purpose of meditation is to develop that wisdom, that discernment, that clarity of vision. That's what samadhi is, really. But this mental collectedness comes from a cause. It is not independent. What is the cause for mental collectedness, and what people would call concentration proper? But here we're really talking about mental collectedness, not forced awareness. And here the Buddha will answer quite clearly. Happiness should be answered. Oh, this is interesting. So this is sukha, obviously. So what is the cause for mental collectedness? He doesn't say to look at an object, he says happiness. Oh, interesting how that works. So wait a minute, what happened? This is often one of the suttas where people will point that out. They'll say like, oh, it's in the Upanishad Sutta. Yes, that's one of them. It's in the Upanishad Sutta, it's in the Samanyapala Sutta, the fruits of the truth-seeking life, the long discourses number 2, and all 11 or 12 discourses that constitute the first chapter of the long discourses all have this in it. It's just that it's, because there's so much repetition in Pali, it's skipped. It's just said like, pay, dot, dot, dot. Payala, like repetition. So people think it's not in there, but it is. Actually, and the long discourses of the Buddha are known to be the first book of the canon. So technically, the people who would start reading the canon would start reading that. The first discourse, like every of the books, is a bit out there, is a bit hard to grasp. But if you just are persevering enough to make it to the second one, then it starts to be more like, oh yeah, this feels more like where somebody should start, you know. And the Buddha explains that very clearly in this, and in the sequence that will follow too. I call it from gladness to collectedness, or natural samadhi. And it's also in all kinds of other discourses, in the suttas. We just have to know them. But this happiness comes from a cause. It is not independent. What is the cause for happiness? Calm should be answered. Pasadi. So cultivating that calm. Sukha is not this excited happiness. It is this special happiness that the Buddha is talking about. Is the happiness of mental clarity, obviously. So this happiness is the happiness that has calm as a cause. So this is also really important to, because sometimes when I say this to people, they happiness is the cause for samadhi, then they're like, woo! Start to, you know, like lose their mind. It's like, no, sorry. Yes, it's very good, but it's the one that is caused by calm. So calming down also, pasadi. And pasadi is also an awakening support, a support of awakening, or a factor of enlightenment, if I use the Bhikkhu Bodhi's terms. But, and what is the cause for happiness? Calm should be answered. But this calm comes from a cause. It is not independent. I think my brain is starting to freeze. My locution is not very good. What is the cause for calm? Joy should be answered. Now we have joy. Okay, that's good. So again, this is the same kind of thing where the Buddha in this one, he doesn't say the niramisa piti. Niramisa means that is not material. It's the joy that is born from mental development, from letting go of unwholesome states, which are heavy, like restlessness, impatience, anger, all these things, or whatever arises in the meditation, just letting it go, seeing there's always tension. Always there's going to be tension with these states. Just letting them go, relaxing that tension, relaxing every bit of it. And then that naturally is, there is quite a bit of relief from that. But also we can make sure that it stays on the right track and bring up a smile. And make sure that with the smile, it's gonna be automatic. It's gonna be, you make sure that really what needs to happen happens, and that's all you need to do. Joy is definitely never to be underestimated. And see, here we have joy, calm, and sukha, happiness. And this is very important. This is what brings us to samadhi and discernment. Right? So this is quite profound, you know. It's quite, when we stop and think about this for a moment, that's the Buddha's teaching. It's like, wow, so beautiful. What is the cause for joy? Relief should be answered. And this is the word, that pamoja word, which is kind of a gladness, or I call it also relief, because it often comes when the Buddha explains when somebody lets go of the five hindrances, then pamoja arises. I mean, at this point, yes, it is gladness also. A lot of people have been translating it as gladness, and I also translate it as gladness. But there is that little flavor that we're kind of missing, where, because, you know, when you let go of a lot of restlessness, and, you know, you, after meditation or something, you know, you feel this kind of gladness. You're glad, but this relief also. It really is this kind of, finally. Especially when the Buddha explains all of his similes for, you know, how, what it feels like to abandon hindrances, like coming out of jail, coming out of debt, kind of thing. And so it's really that sense of relief that is, and this feeds in turn that joy. And again, it's joy that is not associated with anything material. It's that joy that you are producing from inside you through your own practice. So this is quite reliable joy, because the joy outside, you know, somebody can take away your toys at any time, you know, or like the things that we play with or the things that we find happiness with, which is not to say that you shouldn't ever do that or anything, but it's actually it's good to know where really reliable happiness is, and that cannot easily be taken away from you. So, and these things, they are very easy. You know, I can give a talk on it, but the having a retreat, taking a lot of time, you know, this is not a practice that I could ever teach in one day, kind of thing. It's a process. It has to go through different stages, and there has to be a communication to make sure that there's, you know, certain things are done properly, and certain steps are seen and understood, so that there is the real progress towards what is. And often this takes many days. So, but only to hear these words, mind can easily become uplifted, and this sequence happens also. So it's actually, there's a discourse that the Buddha says that in the canon, where only listening to the Dhamma can just generate that within us. So this upliftment. But this relief comes from a cause. It is not independent. What is the cause for relief? Confidence should be answered. And this is that word saddha, which is often translated as faith also. But when we talk about faith here, is really... this is the part where... This is the section where this is the teaching of the Buddha. And now we're going to go into the wheel of samsara, where how this process works, how there is accumulation of identity and things like that, and attachments. But up to here, now this is the route where the Buddha would start giving his talks. I don't know if you remember in the Fruits of the Truth-Seeking Life, he says, that's only just to mention one example, but it says it in many talks, he says, a Tathagata arise in the world, endowed with vision and knowledge, good righteous conduct and righteous knowledge. He teaches the Dhamma that is beautiful in the beginning, beautiful in the middle, beautiful in its ending. And he has this whole, you know, description where... And somebody hears that Dhamma and acquires confidence, not just faith, is that understanding these words, they strike certain chords within us. They make us vibrate onto certain, and it's that the truth of the words that are spoken. Some people only hear that and they become, they gain confidence. They're like, yeah, that makes sense. That's how it works. That's how the mind works. Yes. And this confidence here is not just, of course, yes, there is, you know, hearing that teaching. I mean, it's the same thing today, that this is still his words, you know, what we're hearing, what we're studying. So still 2,600 years later, that is still happening, which is quite amazing. But this confidence, it's also good to understand that, you know, you need faith to start anything. Whatever you do in life, you need faith. Like, if you don't believe that your project is going to work, sorry, but you're never going to do it. Like, if you don't have that initial faith into something. So it's also pointing towards that, whereas it's that kind of spark that makes you kind of take that first step. And of course, he's skipping a few things here between the confidence and the relief, because, I mean, there's a whole kind of practice that goes in between these two here, which could take up quite a bit. He's going into the practice a little bit higher, but, you know, he's not talking about virtue or anything. There are other suttas where he does talk about virtue in v- a very similar way. The Silani, the Kusalani Silani Sutta, the skillful virtues. That's in the Anguttara Nikaya, the book Numerical Discourses. Anyhow, and so how does this confidence arise? So this is now it's a little interesting. But this confidence comes from a cause. It is not independent. What is the cause for confidence? Trouble should be answered. Oh, and this is dukkha. So dukkha is what usually is translated by far and wide as suffering, but it doesn't mean suffering per se. It actually means just dukkha is like hardship, hard times, you know. That this in our language that would be a good way to translate that is what makes you take that first step when you hear the Buddha's words. Have you been seeking for something, or have you been like, but why were you seeking for something? You're not happy, or like, you know, that was not meant in like a particular way. But I was just actually that was meant to be. That was totally directed. I know this is my experience of it. Because like I was feeling like I was really looking for something, but I didn't know what it was, or you know, and I was looking at all these spiritual traditions and going through a quest for meaning, I guess we could say. But this is another way of saying, you know, a bit of a hardship. Maybe in a sense that, so if you're on that kind of quest, that means that, you know, it's not perfect. That means that things are not perfect. You're looking for something, right? Does that make sense? Because we're all looking for happiness. This is universal for sure. But is happiness what we experience 24/7? Well, I mean, there are some pretty good things to be that are happening, especially when you practice. But so sometimes, and that's why you have a lot of people, you know, it's a bit of a cliche in Buddhism, like the guy just becomes a Buddhist monk because he's got like a hard time in his life. Well, actually, that's a bit how you kind of wake up to, like, it's a wake-up call. It's just like, okay, and really it's for the good. A lot of people start searching, a lot of people start looking for therapies and ways of, you know, getting better or whatever, name it, because they know there's something, you know, there's something not right in their life and they want to fix it, and that's just what dukkha means here. We call it also sangvega, that sense of urgency. Sometimes there's stories in the canon where the monks would become kind of lazy or lax. And they just like start chatting and, you know, like being like whatever, not really practicing. And Mahamoggallana would come and he would arouse the sense of urgency in them, as it is said. And he had the psychic abilities. And he'd come in the vihara, in the monastery, and he would just like kick the wall just with the tip of his toe, and the whole thing would just like start to shake. And the monks are like, oh. He's like, practice, monks. So this is how we good friendship in the monastic community. People that when you become careless, they bring you back to the right path, saying, you know, death could arrive any moment. We don't know. We don't know what tomorrow is bringing. So now we're going into samsara, taking the dive. But this trouble comes from a cause. It is not independent. What is the cause of trouble? Renewal of being should be answered. And this is jati, birth. Oh, interesting. So now this is really core to the Buddha's teaching. Obviously, I'm gonna talk about it very briefly. Basically, when we're born, as soon as we're born, we're meant to die at some point. there's no escaping. So usually it ends up in suffering, right? That cycle, because, or just like problems or trouble, like that's because now it's hard to see, but we're gonna talk about each of the chains, why it's like that. But this sutta is very interesting because we're used to hearing that dependent origination, and it's pretty, you know, it's pretty dark. It's like all of this chain, and it's like craving and attachment, and you know, craving, clinging, and like becoming, and then birth, and then you have this whole mass of suffering. Well, that, like it is said in the classic context, but actually, it's really interesting because in this sutta, the Buddha really says, "Well, then what? What do you do with that?" Because dependent origination, the way that it's taught like this in that particular sequence, it feels like it's kind of like, "Oh yeah, that's just the way things are." And but here he gives the solution to the illness. So those are the problems. That's how we create ourselves problems. And what we just said earlier is the way you come out of that. You change for the better. You become happier, more discerning. So, so this renewal of being comes from a cause. It is not independent. So of course now it's also in the context of samsara. It's pretty profound, this dependent origination. I mean, this is how he awoke. It's by contemplating this process of, you know, rebirth, and you know, how does that happen? Like, how do we do this all the time? And so this is what he found. What is the cause for renewal of being? So why do we keep taking birth? And also this is the ultimate sense, but we can also see this as why this is the birth of karma, birth of action. I like both senses because in a way the ultimate one, it really gives you really like the right time about the Buddha's teaching, which shouldn't be forgotten. Because sometimes we tend, and I tend to you know, make it more accessible, and because it works in different ways, but also we shouldn't forget that in the end also he's talking about that, which, you know, when we kind of moderate all the time, we kind of lose that essence, which if we lose, we also lose the liberation, which is not acceptable, because we want to keep that liberation, because if it's becoming too diluted, then we lose the essence, and then we can't use it all the way to the end. So why do we keep renewing these birth after birth, or creating karma all the time, taking actions? But you know, this is more at the level of reaction. So this is more at the level of somebody tells you something you don't like, you just shout at him or her. That's like that level of, that's taking that step, which is, it's a that blind reaction to something that's happening. It's not reflected, you know, it's a trigger, and then there's boom, this birth of, you know, karma. And actually this is like shouting back at someone is never gonna help you in the end. So that's why we need to understand that. It's actually going to make, it's just fueling the chain. What is the cause for renewal of being or renewal of karma of these actions? Identity should be answered. This is bhava. Bhava is also becoming, and this is the sense of identity, which becomes more and more solidified. But how does it get solidified? But this identity comes from a cause. It is not independent. What is the cause for identity? Attachments should be answered. Now, what is this identity? It's just a bundle of attachments. because these identity is I am this, I am that, I like this, I like that, I don't like this, I don't like that, don't give me this, give me that, because my preference is this, not that. And so all of these things, they accumulate, they agglomerate, and in the end, they are the things that we cling to as, this is me. For these attachments to arise, there needs to be an I to arise also that supports all that. And so, these attachments, they are constituted of things that are even finer, which is what these attachments come from a cause, they are not independent. What is the cause for attachments? Discontent should be answered. So what is the root for all these attachments? Interestingly, this would normally be craving and clinging. Attachment is what I call, clinging is what I called attachment. That would be the normal classic way of saying that. And then craving, but I prefer discontent. For me, it makes more sense. Something that I can play more in my mind with. And this discontent is really, like, if we were always perfectly content, how would that be? So, and then from there, we can understand how attachments arise. We start to leaning one way or the other, rather than being okay with whatever arises. Just, this is when it starts to, and one of my favorite teachings from Bhante Ramsey was that actually in relation to non-self is that every time you let go of craving in the mind, every time you let go of a distraction in your mind, every time you let go of the false belief in the personal self, and you become freer and freer every time. And this is a really good anatta teaching, because it's really practical and you can really use it. You can really understand, because every time you just do this exercise, maybe lightly without forcing that, but see what it is when a hindrance arises in the mind, whatever it is, whether it's anger, whether it's wanting something of the senses, whether it's a restlessness, whether it's any of the other hindrances, but these would be the main ones. I would say laziness, but I don't want to too much into that one. There's always going to be a taking it personal, attached to it. And so it works in both ways. It's by letting go of that belief and taking it personal every time, you're also cutting off the root of that hindrance. So it's very profound. And so that's why we train by releasing the hindrances constantly. And that's why samadhi is closer and closer to understanding what anatta is. Because there's nothing there. There's nothing to stick. There's no defilements. Samadhi is the end of defilements. Samadhi is the thing that happens, that unity of mind, that collectedness of mind that happens when all the impurities which are distorting the mind, they're gone. So it's just that natural thing that happens, and this is no, there's no self. There's no, it's very light. It's a very light state. It's very uplifted. And as soon as there's a sense of self or I that comes more and more manifest, then it becomes a hindrance. So this is very interesting to understand. But really, this is also this kind of discontent. And this discontent has a root. And what is this root? All felt experiences should be answered. So what is the cause of discontent is everything that we experience. This is vedana. Vedana is sensations or feeling. But mainly this is everything that you're experiencing. With everything that you're experiencing, whether it's at the ear, at visual cognition, whether it's taste, whether it's touch, whether it's whatever it is, there's an experience. And that experience is, that's the truth. That's the truth of what's happening right now. like it's cold. It's cold and it's touching the skin, and it has this kind of, well, it's not completely unpleasant, I would say, but it's really crisp. and if I were to but this is just the way it is. I mean, I can't change that. This is just what is experienced right now. This is just the sensation that's ongoing. But here is one of the most important links of this chain, is where this is where we have the choice. Where we have the experience that is really happening here and now, and then we have the label that we put on it, or we have the judgment, or we have the opinion, or we have the I want it or I don't want it, or I like it or I don't like it. And this is where all of the problems start, because whether you get angry that it's cold, not gonna change anything. It's actually going to change, yes, it's going to change something. It's going to change that your mind is going to be all over it and all over the place and not peaceful at all. So actually, this is the place in dependent origination where we have really the choice of, and this is also, now it's explained in a very linear way. We have to understand that. But it's not always like that, that the Buddha explains it. Sometimes he explains it differently, in different ways that is less linear. But here would be also, you know, this is where we let go of the hindrances. When you're meditating and you have this experience, because mind is also only just a sense for the Buddha. When you have restlessness arising in the mind, for example, well, that's still an experience. That's still just a sensation. And then you don't take it personal. You don't say, oh, that's me or my meditation. I can't do it and I'm incapable. That's actually feeding the hindrance. No, you just let it do its thing and you let it go. See the tension that came up with it. Like a tight fist around your brain or around your shoulders, and then you let go and you relax that and you let it go. And that's where the path is also. That's when we practice the path, we practice it right there. Before there is, we cultivate the mind, of course, with that joy and tranquility and happiness and collectedness. But that helps us see whenever these distractions arise based upon these sensations. these felt experiences. Oh, that was a lot of material. Yes.
That's excellent. To tie those in.
Yes.
And understand.
Mm-hmm. Well, discontent is whatever arises. I mean, if you're content with the warm breeze, that's great. If you're content with the cold, that's great. That's actually the path. Santosa. Santosa would be the Pali for contentment.
Oh, okay. So contentment, I guess, is what I'm not understanding.
Yes.
So one thing would just be full acceptance.
Yes.
That type of contentment.
Contentment, yes.
But then there's also the pleasant, like, wanting it to continue.
Yes.
Kind of thing,
but
that's more of the craving.
Yes.
But it's not a pushing away of it. Like,
yes.
Discontent.
Yes, yes,
out.
Yes.
So that's, I guess, yeah.
Yes. Good question. I'm happy that you're asking it, because I've been asking myself that question also about the discontent.
Yeah.
And actually, when you want that warm oceanic breeze to come back, that's not contentment. That's discontent. Why do you want it to come back? You're not happy? You're not content? Yes, exactly. That's how it arises, is because when we want something that is not happening here and now, that's I mean, I think that's the definition of discontentment.
Right, or non-acceptance, I guess, in my head.
Not acceptance.
I would
yes.
Yes, as long as I put those two things together, that makes a lot of sense.
Yes. Because it's like craving. A lot of people think that it's just wanting, but actually craving is also not wanting. Because what is not wanting? is still wanting. Is still wanting this thing not. That's just what it is. But it's just because we're used to kind of the way that, I think it's the way that our language works a little bit. It's like... So that's maybe an advantage of Pali, because it's tanha. Tanha is literally, tanha is thirst. So, but it's thirst is that thing of, that's why I discontent also is, I find it quite close to the original. I could, but it's just this thing that makes you, you know, you're not okay with whatever is here. Like, you either want something or you don't want it, but you're not okay. You're just not accepting it. So, and of course I say you, but I don't mean you. I mean, example, nobody you. So. Okay, good. That was a good question. I swore to myself that I would not give a 3-hour talk today, so I will go. I think we're, well, no, that's not true. I was going to say, I think we're through the most critical parts. We kind of are. There still could be a lot of things said about everything, but I think I will just try to drive forward now. But all those felt experiences come from a condition. Oh, now that's interesting. Now we fall into the, also, it's another kind of passive kind of sequence here, where we see now we had a little bit of power to, that's where we have the power to change. But now this is just like a little bit more like factual here, what is going to happen. So these felt experiences, they come from a condition, they are not independent. What is the cause for all felt experiences? Sensory contact should be answered. So whatever arises that is felt, that is an experience, it comes from contact somewhere. This is not really something that we can change, really. This is just, I mean, even if I wanted cold not to contact my skin, it would still do it. There's no way. what is the cause for sensory contact? The six senses should be answered. That just makes quite a bit of sense. But these six senses come from a cause. They are not independent. And see, this is what his line of reasoning when he was thinking about, like, how does birth come to be? You know, it's because of becoming, that identity. And then how does identity, attachments, it's just a pile of attachments. How does attachment come to be? Well, it's just this discontent. Is you're not okay, you're not content accepting of everything. So therefore, there's this building up of attachments. And how does that come to be? It's because of everything that is felt everywhere. There's always this, you know, touch, hearing, judgment, opinion, view, perspective, opinion, personal judgments. How does that happen? Well, it's rooted, this is rooted upon contact. And contact, for contact to be, there needs to be the six senses. There needs to be the senses. For the senses to be, what is the cause of the six senses? Mind and matter should be answered. And now we're really starting to become very how impersonal also this whole process is. Really, it's just mind and matter. But this mind and matter come from a cause. It is not independent. What is the cause of mind and matter? Consciousness should be answered. So here, there's a few ways that this is... Do you have any questions? Okay. So remember in that talk... And that's why I read that talk, actually, is to show that there was another way that the Buddha taught it, and also this Buddha, the Buddha Vipassi, the past Buddha, one of the past Buddhas. The way that he awoke, he said that name and form, like nama rupa, or what I called mind and matter here, and is caused by consciousness, but consciousness also is caused by name and form, or mind and matter. And he says, here it turns back. So sometimes he explains it like that, but here he explains it in another way, where there he talks about the sankharas that constitute consciousness. It's very closely related. I mean, and you know, like in the Madhupindika, the Honeyball discourse, he'll say, form, it hits the eye, and this is contact. The meeting of the three is called consciousness. Yeah, this is consciousness. So this is eye consciousness. From that, he explains with craving, right? So interesting that, in fact, here he says it in one way, but in the Honeyball discourse, he'll say, no, actually, this is all dependent on, well, basically, well, that's a bit like saying name and form, like I and form, this is contact, and then consciousness arises from that. But then, see, here he says consciousness is kind of born out of contact. Whereas here it's like coming from, you know. So we have to understand that this is all supporting each other. It's not necessarily poured into concrete, like linear like this. But it does work like that. I mean, it's so closely related, all of these things. Because the six senses, what are the six senses? I mean, it's dependent on mind and matter. I mean, if there's not that mind and matter, the six senses are not. But if and this is the cause for contact also. But it's like also these sankharas, you know, as soon as there's a sankhara, I mean, there's contact. I mean, there's no choice. Like that's, I mean, as soon as there's a sankhara arising, there is contact. So it's to be careful not to make concrete out of this, but it's really helpful to understand. Do you have a question?
No, but I have had challenges understanding this because of that.
Yes. How can there be no consciousness if there is going to be I and form? Like, I mean, how could there be I and form if there's no consciousness in the first place?
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
Yes. Very good question. I would say that in this particular... a lot of the time, that's what I do with the Buddhist teaching, is that I feel he has all these ways of explaining things, and that's why I'm very careful, and I really like to use his own words and his own methods, because it's very specific and it's very tricky to, you know, play with these things and change them without changing something that is like, oh no no no, don't play with that. I like to really keep them in their boxes, each individually. I think that particular teaching is to help us understand how that the impersonality of, because I think it works in both ways, right? There is this vijnana, consciousness can arise through sankharas, which is what we're going to talk here, because here, see, he says, but this consciousness comes from a cause, huh? And that's a big feature of the Buddha's teaching, is that it's not a steady stream of endless, you know, consciousness. That it is actually dependent on causes to arise. It is not independent. What is the cause of consciousness? Mental activities, sankharas, should be answered. But these mental activities come from a cause, they are not independent. What is the cause of mental activities? Lack of discernment should be answered. Now this is completing the whole sequence, and we can talk a little bit about that. But so here, there is, sankharas is also twofold, we need to understand, is that they are, in a way, sankharas are what we have accumulated, like the impressions that are like the conditionings, mental conditionings, that are these activities of the mind that are just happening. You know, when you do a lot of things and you're really involved in a lot of things and then you just go and sit, how's your mind? It's super restless. Well, that's sankhara. That's exactly what those sankharas are. It's because you've been sankhara-ing your mind in a lot of activities, and now it's used to being going. But what we do in meditation is sabba sankhara samato. We calm down these sankharas, we bring them down, and then we start to see clearly. It's really how it is. But these sankharas, they go really deep. Then they have very tiny, tiny roots, tiny seeds. And we really have to have a really sharp mind to see that. The last levels of the meditation, neither perception or non-perception, or nothingness and neither perception and non-perception, what I call the limit of awareness, this is where you would start seeing these bijas, these tiny roots, tiny roots of sankharas. It's like seeing the beginning of the movement of a sankhara before it happens. It's like this boop, and then like, oh no. it releases on autopilot at that point, really. It's just, you're not really thinking too much about it, because thinking would be just way too coarse for this state, but it's just sharpening letting go at that level. So the sankharas is twofold, is the things that are already pre-conditioned within us that are arising. And also sankharas, they are also the action. They are also what they are also being created, if you may, by this craving, clinging and identity. This discontent, attachment and identity part. That this is how we create sankharas, by judging everything that happens with the senses. And so this really helps us understand that this consciousness that is arising, consciousness always needs something to lean on. There's the simile the Buddha said, it's like two stacks of hay, or that kusa grass in India, that they're piled together like this. If you take one, the other one falls. So this is exactly like that. This is dependent origination. And consciousness always needs something to be conscious of. So that's that nama rupa. So that's how it's so important. But here we go even behind that, and we understand that this consciousness that exists before there is a sense contact, you know, like there's that sensory impingement where there would be eye form. There is that contact right now. There is contact. It's too fast, we can't say it, but the consciousness that is seeing that before, that consciousness is conditioned by all these sankharas that were there already. And just the fact that we have body is one of these conditions. Like, body has consciousness. If body doesn't have consciousness, there's death. So, but this is just one of the vital ones. We have to understand that we have a lot of things piled up on that, and for example, right now I am creating these sankharas of giving a talk. I'm talking, so I have to. There's a lot of action. Of course, it's one of the best kinds of action because it's talking about Dhamma. So, it's good. But mind is also, you know, it's not like in meditation 2 hours ago. So those sankharas are a little bit coarser. But this is what also is projecting consciousness always. It's like as soon as you come out of the deeper states of meditation, you can see that process very, very well, because as soon as there's the world again and the six senses back into action coming up live, then there is, you know, we can see that right away. Awareness becomes way more real, way heavier, way denser, because of that consciousness that was in, let's say, in nothingness or neither perception or non-perception, that was very refined and subtle and barely perceptible even, right? But as soon as we think, oh, it's 11, now it's time to eat and it's time to things, and then and now we have more, and then opening up the eyes, sensory impingement, where just before that there was almost a complete letting go of dependent of the causes for all of this, and there was barely any consciousness. I mean, that's what Nirodha is, right? It's Nirodha Samapatti is the cessation of feeling and perception, or experience and perception, is just the blowing out of consciousness, which for us Westerners, it's the cessation of consciousness seems a bit it seems pretty intense, but actually that's what liberation is, really. Nibbana, that's what it is. It's the blowing out of that constant, because consciousness is not still. It's always going. But at that point, we need to be already, to have sensory impingement, there is already quite a bit going on. That doesn't mean it's unwholesome. That just means it's active already. So there is already, that consciousness is already active. It's already, you know, it's already aware of body. It's aware of activities. So that sensory engagement, the thing is that it's happening so fast. It's hard for us. It's like when you watch a 4K, I don't know, resolution, whatever, film, is like 100 frames per second. You don't see the frames. It's like you don't see the frames, but it's all frames. You know, all these videos is all, it's all like 20, 25, 30, 60, 60 frames per second. That's how it's measured. And it's the same thing with our reality. I don't know how many contacts per seconds, but I'm not sure if I want to know it. I'm sure science is kind of starting to figure out things like that. And that's why it's we get fooled by it, because it's so fast that we really think, well, like Goenka says, it's so fast, like the flame of the candle. It's flickering, it's rising and passing, but it's doing it so fast that we don't see it, we don't realize it. It's the same thing with these contact, the IE meeting form, which is contact, and these three, and that's just one sense. That means you're looking at that particular sense. That means that you're kind of paying attention, like I'm looking at you right now. So some awareness is going towards that. I'm not necessarily, earlier I was talking and I was looking at you and the birds were chirping, the bald eagles, and I didn't hear it right away because I wasn't paying attention to that. Because I was paying attention to you. And so, see, that's how it works. Like, that's not that it wasn't happening, but, you know, there was sound hitting the ear, it was making contact and creating consciousness, but it was not the prevalent experience. It was not, you know, what was so there's varying degrees of that too. We need to understand that this, because I mean, this is happening at all six senses all the time. I mean, so so there's quite a lot of of stimulation going on. So yeah, this is. Two main aspects of this dependent origination, how it works and how consciousness arises from previous activities and conditioned activities of the mind, and also how it arises even more throughout the senses, throughout sensory contact, which both are true. So I guess I was saying all of this to you to say that both are true and they're both accurate, And they actually overlap each other. They're not really dissociated. They're just, I think actually it's quite helpful to know both, to know that this process of sensory engagement and how it creates consciousness, and on this, because if that didn't happen, we couldn't judge it. We couldn't, you know, there wouldn't be a, like, I like or I don't like. So this is quite important. And also this I like, I don't like, it gets stored into sankharas, and these are also creating consciousness. So this is also creating that. We could talk about that for a long time. Okay, let's so lack of discernment to stillness. Now the other way around, and now I'm not going to talk as much. It's because it's good also to just hear it. It does something profound. In this way, monks, because of lack of discernment, there arise mental activities. Because of mental activities, there arises consciousness. Because of consciousness, there arise mind and matter. Because of mind and matter, there arises the six senses. Because of the six senses, there arises sensory contact. Because of sensory contact, there arises all felt experiences. Because of all felt experiences, there arises discontent. Because of discontent, there arises attachments. Because of attachments, there arises identity. Because of identity, there arises renewal of being. Because of renewal of being, there arises trouble. Now, because of trouble, there arises faith. Because of faith, there arises relief. Because of relief, there arises joy. Because of joy, there arises calm. Because of calm, there arises happiness. Because of happiness, there arises collectedness. Because of collectedness, there arises discernment. Because of discernment, there arises disengagement. Because of disengagement, there arises complete letting go. Because of complete letting go, there arises release. Because of release, there arises the knowledge of stillness. Just as when it pours down heavily on the mountaintops, that water rushes down, filling up the main valleys and gorges. The main valleys and gorges being full, they fill the streams. The streams being full, they fill the creeks. The creeks being full, they fill the rivers. The rivers being full, they fill the estuaries. The estuaries being full, they fill the great ocean. In the same way, monks, lack of discernment produces mental activity. Now, this is slight word play here, just to implement a different kind of outlook. He would say the same thing usually, but I just wrote produce instead, because that's another way that I like it. It creates another way of seeing it, which is nice. But he repeats it again. Lack of discernment produces mental activities. And see here, we're really talking about up to the finest level, right? These are the hindrances. The hindrances is, you know, when we talk about avijja, like ignorance. It's not ignorance, you don't know anything. It's like ignorance is like hindered. It's being hindered. So that's what that means, that lack of discernment. Lack of discernment produces mental activities, because hindrances. Mental activities produce consciousness. Consciousness produces mind and matter. Mind and matter produces the six senses. The six senses produce sensory contact. Sensory contact produces all felt experiences. Felt experiences produce discontent. Discontent produces attachment. And here, obviously, this is our choice, right? It produces discontent if we don't train, if we choose to. Discontent produces attachments. Attachments produce identity. Identity produces renewal of being. Renewal of being produces trouble. Trouble produces confidence. Confidence produces relief. Relief produces joy. Joy produces calm. Calm produces happiness. Happiness produces collectedness. Collectedness produces discernment. Discernment produces disengagement. Disengagement produces complete letting go. Complete letting go produces release. Release produces the experience of stillness. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Good. Oh, my pleasure. It's one of the big ones. It's very important, especially for us, understand, like, when, because we practice really this. It's like that, the joy and the calm and the happiness that produces collectedness. It's like the happy dependent origination. Yes. Or like less, it feels like a little bit like we have something that we can play with, at least, huh? Because when we just read it the way that it's just the 12 links with just the craving, and it's like, yeah, but where's my choice? Well, it's not always explained that the where feeling and craving is, that's right there is the choice. And the path is not always explained either. Like, oh yeah, okay, so you really see is that those 12 links, they are that explanation of why we get stuck with ourselves. But how do you get unstuck? That's what I'm interested about. But I guess we need to know. For me, how I see this also is, this is a beautiful template of the Four Noble Truths. You have dependent origination, which is telling you about the first and the second. And then you have the path, which is a continuity of what he says there, which is the third and the fourth, the release and the path. So this sutta explains, by dependent origination, the Four Noble Truths in this way. So it's quite how to see it, because we need to see it. We need to see it. We need to see, we need to know how the mechanism, how it works, to stop it, and then do the path to release. So sometimes I say also, you can have craving for the path, you know, this is good. You can develop the healthy dependence, healthy dependent origination. You develop desire for jhana, for dhamma, for more meditation, happiness that comes from meditation. Then actually you're using dependent origination. That's another way that I put it sometimes. You actually can use it for wholesome, because the Buddha says, you know, we use chanda, which is wholesome desire, to practice this path. So we create sankharas that are wholesome. we condition our minds to be wholesome. So whenever the built-in sankharas come up, whenever they come up, they will be wholesome. So at least they will be helping us on the path. So at least they won't be as heavy bringing us down. So the path is also conditioning ourselves through these links, but in a healthy, wholesome way. Yes. Okay. Maybe we share merit. Dukkha patta jani dukkha bhaya patta jani bhaya soka patta jani soka hontu sabbe bipanino idang no punyang sabbe satta numorantu sabba sampatti siddhya aga satta jabumatta Devanaga Mahidika Punyang Tanganu Moritva Chirang Rakanta Buddha Sasasanang. May suffering ones be suffering free and the fear struck fearless be. May the grieving shed all grief and may all beings find relief. May all beings share these merits that we have thus acquired for the acquisition of all kinds of happiness. May beings inhabiting space and earth, devas and nagas of mighty powers, share these merits of ours. May they long protect the Buddha Sasana. Sasana.